Please wait, I'm starting a YouTube live. The most important session of the third day conference, that is the oral presentation from the research scholars as well as from the postdocs. Thank you all. Now session is over to the review committee members.
Sir, please unmute.
Yeah. Thank you, Dr. Lohanathan. So good morning on all present here. So today we'll start our oral presentation. So the first participant would be Dr. Karthik Balakrishna, and he's a research associate from Department of Industrial and Physical Chemistry, Physical Pharmacy, Purdue University, USA. Dr. Karthik, the time starts now. Please share your screen and then start your presentation.
So, are you able to see my screen clearly?
Yeah.
Okay. Hello, everyone. And I really thank Dr. Lohanathan for giving me this opportunity. And it's my great pleasure to be here. So today, I'd like to share with you how we use a solid-state HDX-MS as a method to predict the long-term storage stability of lyophilized antibody formulations. So to begin with, I would like to say why we need this particular method. So, majority of protein drugs, including monoclonal antibodies, are often stored as amorphous powders because moisture actually can degrade them at any stage. And out of 107 protein drugs that has been approved by US FDA for the past, from 2006 to 2016, 43% of them are solids. They are all either produced by lyophilization or freeze drying or by another method called spray drying. And even during lyophilization or spray drying, the degradation can occur. And until now, there are only few analytical methods that are available for protein characterization in solids, which all have low resolution and they are all semi-quantitative. So that is why we need a method that can predict storage stability at a very short duration of time. And our method can do that. So we all know that proteins are made of amino acids, and amino acids are all connected through peptide backbones. But and these the hydrogens present in the protein can be characterized into three groups actually. So in our study, we are mainly dealing with the proteins with the hydrogens that form the peptide backbone, which have a medium range of exchange. Medium rate of exchange in when they are put in deuterium environment. That means the protein
Hi Karthik. Karthik, I think we missed you.
Arun? Have we lost the connection?
Yeah, I think we lost the connection.
At Karthik's place.
It's connected, maybe because of the some
net problem, I think.
Yeah.
So probably can we go to the next one or?
Yeah, I think probably we'll.
He's in live.
Line?
Yes.
Yeah, he's back.
Yeah. You can call him and ask if he's able to hear our voice.
Yeah.
I think he can disconnect.
We can wait for one more minute because for him it is actually 6:30 a.m. in US. We can give one more minute for him to join. Otherwise, then we can move to the next speaker.
After
I cannot reach him actually. There is some problem with his network.
Okay, that is the case. Maybe we can call him again for if we have time. We can call him again.
Yeah, sure. So then, can we stop sharing his screen?
Yeah, if I allowed other participants.
Yeah. So next we'll go to Ms. Aditi Jain. Is she here?
Hello.
Yeah. So Aditi Jain, she's from Center for Biosystems Science and Engineering, IIC Bangalore. She'll present on in vitro disease model for skeletal muscle degeneration. So you'll be given 10 minutes, out of which eight minutes presentation and 2 minutes question and answer sessions. So we'll ring a bell at sixth minute. So you can start your presentation now.
Is my screen visible?
Yeah, your screen is visible now. Yeah.
Hello. Good morning, everyone. I'm thrilled to be given this opportunity to present at today's conference. And today I'll be going to talk about our ongoing work on in vitro disease model for skeletal muscle degeneration carried out at Indian Institute of Science under fantastic guidance of advisors Professor Kaushik Chatterjee and Dr. Raghav Lingam Ravi Sundaresan. To begin with, skeletal muscle makes largest organ of the body, comprising 40% of the body weight, and I think often underappreciated for that reason. It is required in all the day-to-day activities that we do, and needless to say, the lockdown special activities we have to do daily, like cleaning and cooking, talking, writing research articles, moving from one place to another. Now you can imagine
Aditi?
Now, can we stop the YouTube connection so that this problem will not come? I'm not sure if it is because of that.
Dr. Loganathan?
Yes, ma'am.
Is she still with us?
Wind.
Yes, she was in line.
So can we disconnect the YouTube because of that?
Okay, ma'am, that I will do. Okay.
Yeah, I think probably we'll go to Karthik's talk and then we'll come back to Aditi's.
Please, Aditi, please join again in 7 more minutes. We'll go for Karthik's presentation. Karthik, please go share your screen.
Sure, yeah.
So Karthik will be given 8 minutes presentation. Sixth minute, you'll get a ring. Then you'll have 2 minutes to wind up.
Okay. So thank you. So I don't know where I got lost, but I'll just start from beginning. I'll just say why we need this particular solid state HDX MS analysis. So many protein drugs, including MAPS, are often stored as amorphous solid powders because moisture will actually destroy the protein drugs actually. So out of 107 protein drug products that has been approved by US FDA, 43% of them are solids. They are all produced either by lyophilization or spray drying, mainly lyophilization or spray drying actually. So degradation can still occur during lyophilization, that means the freeze drying, and also during storage. There are only few analytical methods available for protein characterization in solids, which all have low resolution and they are semi-quantitative. So that is why we actually need a method method to predict the long-term storage stability of therapeutic drugs in a very short duration of time. And we all know that protein are made of amino acids connected through peptide backbone. And these backbone hydrogens have a medium range of exchange when they are put in a deuterium environment. That means they exchange with deuterons, but the exchange rate is medium in such a way that we can be captured by mass spectrometry. Whereas the other protons, which are shown in gray in color, are completely non-exchangeable, or they exchange very slow. Are those which are acidic, which are shown in white color, they are actually have a very fast exchange, so they cannot be trapped in a mass spectrometry. So let us see how we utilize this particular backbone protons, and we use this to predict the long-term storage stability of proteins. So as I said, we are dealing only with the backbone protons here. So in this cartoon, you can see the blue colored dots are all hydrogens, backbone hydrogens on a protein. When it is exposed to deuterium environment, they get exchanged at different rates depending on where the proton is there located. If the proton is in the unstructured region or the exposed region, it gets exchanged very fast. But if it is involved in the intramolecular hydrogen bonding, it may or may not get exchanged. So at different time points, these proteins can be quenched. The exchange can be quenched by putting them in liquid nitrogen and analyzed by mass spec. Mass spectrometry is like a very sensitive method that actually can exactly determine how many deuterons has been exchanged at what time point actually. So using this, we actually take the lyophilized molecules, lyophilized antibodies, which are mostly lyophilized together with excipients, which are shown on this slide, like sucrose, trehalose, or mannitol. And we actually keep them in a desiccator, sealed desiccator, which has deuterium vapor in it. And these deuterium vapor are generated by dissolving salts in saturated salt in D2O liquid. So then these vapors enter into the lyophilized cakes, and the exchange occurs. And we quench them at different time points. And with mass spectrometry, we actually determine how many deuterons are exchanged and at what level actually at different time points. So with this data, we are actually kind of plotting the number of deuteron uptake with respect to time for different formulations. That means protein with different sugar moiety, they will actually have different deuteron uptake. This is mainly because of the hydrogen bonding efficiency of the sucrose molecule over the protein that can protect the protein from the surroundings actually. So what we say is lesser the deuteron uptake, more the stability of the protein. But this is actually has been proved for several model proteins and several monoclonal antibodies. And there are a few pharmaceutical companies have even adapted this method. The main reason is most of the storage stability experiments need few months to a year to predict the storage stability. But our method, if you can see the bottom graph, needs only 10 days actually. It's 240 hours, needs only 10 days to predict the storage stability. So by this way, we actually can do the job within few days, like within a shorter period of time that can predict long-term storage stability. So I thank and I acknowledge the great minds behind this work, and thank you for giving me the opportunity.
Thank you, Karthik.
Thank you.
Nice presentation. I have a few questions for you. So you said using this technique, you'll be able to predict storage stability for 10 days, yep. Right? So how could we extrapolate to like months or years? How long can we extrapolate?
Yeah, so we actually need only 10 days to do the experiment. But this, if you see the graph shown here as a D, this is the correlation for a storage stability that has been previously done using size exclusion chromatography for a few months actually. So our 10 days data can correlate with the long-term storage stability. It already has a very good correlation.
I see. So you are changing the protein structure. When I say structure, so you're basically modifying hydrogen to deuterium, right?
So even that modification will affect the structure, right? Like, me, have you tested the structural property of these proteins after changing?
Sure. Sure. What we do, all different analysis like DSC, CD, FTIR, to ensure that the time zero and after our analysis, the structure hasn't been modified actually. There's no change in structure or confirmation.
Okay. Arun, please go ahead.
Yeah, Dr. Karthik.
Yeah.
So do you expect any change in the pH of this kind of protein solution, antibody solution after this shift?
After this? Not really, because all these are under solid conditions.
Okay.
So we cannot even measure pH in this region, actually, in this experiment.
Suppose after this change, after this shift, and then if protein is into liquid form whenever it is going to be like in application. So do you see, hope or do you guess any pH change, because that is very crucial for protein activity?
Sure. I get your point. So here, in this particular experiment, we use only 11% relative humidity.
Okay.
So it will take several months for it to completely dissolve the sample. So it will still be an intact cake after 10 days, after 2 months even.
Okay, all right.
So that, yeah.
Thank you.
Any other questions from others, for the other panelists? So I have a quick question. So this is basically a technology which we could use to see whether the protein is stable during the storage process.
Yeah.
So how cost effective is it when compared to the existing characterization techniques?
Sure. So the only cost that we have here is using D2O solution and then having a mass spec in the lab. So this is like mass spec is like a one-time investment. And D2O is also like one-time investment. Once you make a desiccator, it can be used for a couple of years, actually. So so main thing is it can cut down the time duration. That is our major,
Okay, thank you. So since there's no other questions, so we'll be thanking Dr. Karthik for a good presentation. Thank you so much for joining with us.
Thank
so we'll
you.
Go to the next presenter. I think Aditi will join us now. So can you please stop sharing your screen, Karthik? Yeah. So Aditi, can you please share your screen?
Sure, sir. Am I audible?
Yeah, you're audible. So you'll be given 8 minutes to present and 2 minutes question. So please go ahead.
Sure. Good morning, everyone. Today, I'll talk about our ongoing work on in vitro disease model for skeletal muscle degeneration. So skeletal muscle form the largest organ of the human body, comprising 40% of body weight. Skeletal muscles are involved in a variety of functions that we carry out. In fact, all the functions that we carry out are due to skeletal muscle. It can thus be stated that any disability or any element of skeletal muscle disease can lead to a big compromised function of the human body. This makes skeletal muscle diseases a leading contributor to disability across the world, as stated by World Health Organization. However, skeletal muscle has this beautiful regeneration process that it can carry out to overcome this disability. So they have a pool of stem cells which can differentiate on demand whenever there's an injury to become specialized cells called myoblasts. These myoblasts can then fuse to form myotubes, and myotubes, they bundle together to form these myobundles. However, with age or a large volumetric loss, cancer, and various disorders, this regeneration capacity can be compromised, or in many cases, it's dysfunctional as well. So there have been many drugs that have been tested to see if they can heal the muscle or bring about repair. However, there's a big discrepancy in how many drugs that come out and how many drugs get approved in the clinical trial. So the percentage is almost 12%, meaning to say if there were 10 drugs that went for clinical trial, only 12 of them got approved. This leads to a big loss of money, and obviously all the resources and the time spent, which comes out to be almost 2.5 billion. So we started asking what could be the reason for this low efficiency? And this led us to a question: do we have the right laboratory platforms to test anything related to skeletal muscle? Do we have the right model systems to even study the function of skeletal muscle? And could this be accounting for the discrepancy that they are not approved or they not function in the clinical setting? So towards this, our first step was to see how skeletal muscles are actually arranged in the body. Is there a particular way that they are arranged and that we are missing out at the laboratory dishes? So now if you look at the in vivo tissue section of a heart, suppose you take a thin section of a skeletal muscle, we see that the cells are very well arranged, they're very well organized, and you can see they follow this directionality. That means they are all arranged in one direction. However, if we see the cells that are cultured in laboratory dishes, of what we call this TCPS, tissue culture polystyrene plates, we see that the cells are arranged in all the directions and they don't follow any inherent directionality. So we thought maybe could this be a reason that the skeletal muscle function at a substandard way in this laboratory setting, and we test all the drugs on them and then they don't turn out to be effective in the clinical setting. So towards this, our first major challenge was to obtain a reliable source of skeletal muscle. For this, we went on to standardize a very efficient protocol. In the interest of time today, I will not be discussing this protocol. And what we found, we could obtain these nicely twitching skeletal muscles from mouse, and they did not require any external stimuli for them to twitch. However, what we could see, these cell twitching is brought about these currents flowing. And here you can see that there is actually no current, a coordinated current flowing. And with time, what we also see is these skeletal muscles, when they start to twitch, they randomly lift off from the tissue culture plates, making it very difficult to carry out experiments. And we faced a lot, for a long time, we were just stuck with this, that the cells were not even left on the plates to for us to do any experimentation. So we followed a very simple proof of concept approach, that if there was a way that we could confine the growth of these cells in one direction and put them in some channels. So we made use of photolithography molds and poured PDMS and got these beautiful patterns of 50 micron size, and thought if there was a way these cells could sit here and follow the direction of these channels and hence become aligned. And could it be that this the confinement of cell helps them not to lift off? And now, when we grow our skeletal myoblast isolated from muscle on this patterned substrate, we do see that the skeletal muscle, they are all aligned in one direction as opposed to the flat surfaces. And this aligned arrangement gives the muscle an edge towards differentiation. So they are better able to fuse with each other, and we see a marked increase in differentiation. However, still, the cells could not be cultured for a longer time and the cells lifted off. So now we started thinking if there was a way that we could align the cells as well as retain them in culture for a longer duration. So we thought of making something like a mesh-like structure which could hold the cell or probably entangle the cell so that they don't lift off from the surface. For this, we made use of a polymeric substrate, polymeric nanofibers PCL. It is a biocompatible, FDA approved, and slow degrading polymer. We wanted slow degrading so that we can culture the cells for as long as we want and the culture substrate itself doesn't get dissolved away.
Aditi?
Until 21 days, we saw this. Yes, sir. Yeah. So next, this, hello?
Yeah, please go ahead.
Next, we tested, since the polymeric substrates are usually hydrophobic, we coated the scaffolds with ECM proteins like gelatin and fibronectin to see if it gives an edge to these cells to grow or to differentiate. However, we found no difference in the uncoated surfaces as well as the coated surfaces, suggesting that the polymeric substrates was hydrophilic enough for the cells to grow. And then we went on to confirm it using water contact angle, and we saw that just the culture media was enough to make the scaffolds hydrophilic for cell attachment. So this came as an additional advantage to us, that we didn't require any PCM coating for the cells to grow. We then tracked a day-wise improvement of, we tracked the growth of cells on the scaffold. By day one, we saw that the cells now were aligned, so they started differentiating early at day one itself. And by day three, they started forming these bundles giving, as opposed to the cells cultured on the random substrate or the flat surface. And by day 14, what we saw is that although on the PCPs, the cells were lifting off and clustering at one point, they were still attached to these aligned PCL nanofibers. Next, we went on to check the SEM images to see if they were actually lifting off, and we did see the same thing in the SEM images that you can see on the flat surface. The cells, although they form these tubes, they are starting to lift off, whereas they remain attached here. Now, this was a validation of, now we have the cells cultured on dishes. Now, how do they outperform in terms of function? Can they mimic the basal level function of skeletal muscle? For this, we checked the glucose uptake, which is the most important function of a skeletal muscle in response to insulin. And in the presence of insulin, this molecule, there's a lot of downstream signaling that happens, which can be captured in terms of phosphorylation of AKT, which opens the door for glucose to enter. So we track the levels of phospho-AKT, and we found that the cells were very sensitive to the increasing time duration of insulin, which is very difficult to capture on the culture dishes, where we see a very random expression of phospho-AKT, meaning to say the cells were maturing at a progressive rate and responding how they would do in an environmental scenario. Next, we treated to see if they could mimic a muscle degeneration condition using a dexamethasone tube. And we found that although the cells on the TCPS were also undergoing degeneration, there was a great heterogeneity in terms of the muscle fiber diameter, as we can see from the images. However, it was much more coordinated in the aligned PCL fibers. With this, I can say our culture system can be used for long-term culturing of cells, and we can also use it to study the long-term effect of drugs. And it is a very simple system with just nanofibrous substrate with no requirement of PCM, and can be scaled up. And whatever calculations of fiber diameter are done are more reliable. In the context of COVID, also, this is very useful where there is no information of how skeletal muscles are affected due to coronavirus. And this model system can come handy to test by infecting it with virus and see how it affects. With that, I would like to finish by saying I'm a part of this wonderful groups at ISC, and I'm ready to take any questions.
Thank you so much, Aditi. It's a very nice presentation. So we'll go to questions now.
Sure.
So you said you have presented two different systems, right? One is the micro pattern structure, and the other one is the nanofibrous structure. So is there any relation between them, or is it like just two different systems?
So we started. So these the pattern substrate are much more controlled in a way. So we started with that because we can vary the groove dimensions, and they are much more scalable. You can have a mold and then just pour PDMS. So we started off, it seemed like a more scalable process. And the idea we had in mind before making these skeletal muscle model was it should be scalable. It should not be something very fancy that half the people or half the biologists cannot adopt. So we just started very proof of concept, but it just turned out that although they were channels, they were still a smooth surface, a smooth channel. So they needed something much. So we also actually did a lot of variations of that micro patterning, which I have not discussed here in interest of time. We did different kinds of coating. We gave plasma treatment, but nothing could prevent the cell lifting off. So it was just an on-demand thing that these patterns didn't work. So we had to shift to a more fibrous like structure, and then electrospinning came handy for that.
Okay. So how elastic are these nanofibrous structure? Are they like suitable for skeletal cells? Have you checked that the mechanical property of these scaffolds?
So I have not checked for this study, but these kind of scaffolds we have used for some other study, and we found that the elasticity doesn't match the tissue as much. It's actually so the Young's modulus comes out to be megapascal. This, so if you reduce the elasticity a lot, then they become brittle and they tend to break out. But we don't see any difference that with the stiffness also that the differentiation is affected. So the cells are still able to survive and able to function. The basal, so that's what we did the way they do in viral scenario. But that would be a best scenario where we can have the stiffness also matching the muscle tissue, and yet they are not brittle or they don't break. That would be an ideal system.
So I have a question. Dr. Namik, please go ahead.
Yeah, hi Aditi, nice presentation, nice work.
Hi, sir.
My question is on that water contact angle, and then PCL, and then when you coated with the ECM-like materials, there was no change in hydrophilicity or hydrophobicity. So it is very established that PCL is very hydrophobic. So the water contact angle goes like 117, 120.
Right.
What was the reason that pure PCL material in your case was also not so hydrophobic, but it was hydrophilic? Any reason?
So I'll just go back to the slide. So our neat PCL did show hydrophobic. So if you see our neat PCL, it is touching. So can you see the slides? I'll just switch this. So this neat PCL, if you see, sir, which is uncoated, it is showing hydrophilic. It is more than 100, meaning that it is hydrophobic. Now, when we dip it in gelatin, which has it is made up of proteins and amino acids. So when we dip, there is a physical adsorption of these proteins on the surface. So we dip it for 1 or 2 hours at the incubator. So there's a physical adsorption, not a chemical. And similarly, if you just dip them in the culture media, which is also made up of proteins and a lot of ions, it just gets physically adsorbed on the surface and makes the scaffold transiently hydrophilic, and then the cells can attach at that point. And the beauty of these myoblasts that we have cultured here, if you see, so if you see these myoblasts, they have this property of secreting their own ECM. So once they attach, they start to secrete their own ECM. And then they don't require any coating. So it's just the transient attachment which can be carried out just by the media, for which physical adsorption is enough.
Perfect explanation. Thank you so much.
Thank you Aditi, for a nice explanation. So with interest of time, we'll wind up this session. Okay, probably other panelists can ask questions privately later with you. So we'll go to the next presenter. So thank you for presenting. The next presenter is Kamini. She's also from Center for Biosystems Science and Engineering, IIC Bangalore. So Dr. Kamini. Dr. Kamini?
Yes, sir.
Could you hear me?
Yes, I can hear
you. Yeah, please go ahead with your presentation.
Can you all see my...
We could see your presentation,
Okay. Good morning, all. I'm a dentist, Dr. Kanthi at...
Your voice is slightly... can you please increase your volume in the system, probably?
Okay, just give me a second. Is it audible now?
Yeah.
Okay, I'm sorry about that. Okay, I'm Kamini. I'm a dentist and I'm doing my PhD under Dr. Rachit Agarwal in the drug delivery lab at BSSC, IISc. I'm basically, thank you for giving me this opportunity to present my research work here. I'm basically working on developing rapamycin-based PUGA carriers for treatment of osteoarthritis. We all know that osteoarthritis is a very common knee joint disease prevalent all over the world. By the end of 2020, it is projected to be affecting around nearly 29% of the world population. what happens basically in osteoarthritis is that there is destruction of articular cartilage and adjoining subchondral bone. While there are no treatments that modify the disease, there are only treatment which is currently available in clinics, which addresses only the pain and the inflammation associated with it, with the viscosupplementation supplementation giving only marginal improvements and the surgery as the last resort. So it is seen that with aging or with any injury to the knee joint, what happens is that the coverage of the bone, that is the cartilage, gets eroded over time or with injury. And the chondrocytes, which are supposed to do the synthesis and turnover of the ECM, does not actually do the job because they have the sole mechanism of nutrition by only autophagy, because the cartilage tissue by itself is avascular in nature. So these chondrocytes, instead of going into this repair mode, what they do is actually they are not able to do the job of repairing the cartilage. So they go into a state of apoptosis, or they become senescent and they spoil the entire health of the cartilage. Thereby, the knee joint will go into further depreciation, and then we have to go for total knee arthroplasty. So as I've told before, autophagy is a very important nutrient mechanism for the chondrocytes. And there is always a basal level of autophagy that is happening, but what happens is with stress or with aging, the autophagy levels come down at the cells. So there are many drugs that has been recently used in the field now, where they're targeting autophagy inducers so that the autophagy can be induced in all these cells so that they can actually kickstart their metabolism and start to repair the cells. So rapamycin is one such drug, which has been widely used in the clinic as an immunomodulator and as an antibiotic for like around 20 years. But it has shown some promise in the osteoarthritis treatment, where by direct injection of rapamycin into the knee joint, it brought about some decrease in the osteoarthritis symptoms in a mice model. But the major problem with that was that it's a free drug, so it gets rapidly cleared from the knee joint. So also many drugs like these autophagy inducers, senolytic drugs, and all of these drugs, what they do is they are very small, around 2 to 3 nanometers in size. So they exit their joint very fast, and they're available only in very less quantity for the drug to reach the therapeutic concentration. So what we wanted to do is to develop a quick translational material, which is widely accepted in clinics and famous and successful in clinics also, so that we can push all these bottlenecked drugs into the clinical phase and into the translational phase, so that the people can actually experience the treatment or using the autophagy inducers. So so that is what we need. We need a controlled delivery system, where it has been widely seen that PLG is widely used in the clinics as a successful candidate to encapsulate drugs and deliver them easily for a longer duration. So based on this, we formed our project hypothesis, wherein when a healthy cell is there, with stress or with trauma, they actually, if autophagy activation occurs, nutrient recycling happens and the cell go into cell revival mode and the health of the joint is maintained. Why? If the autophagy is not activated properly, the cells can go into senescence and apoptosis and the joint health is altered. So here is where we want to intervene, where we are going to give rapamycin in the form of carriers, which can push the cells into the cell survival mode rather than stopping it from going into the cell senescence or cellular apoptosis mode. So with this idea in the mind, we went ahead and we encapsulated our rapamycin in our PLG microparticles, and we did some particle characterization in them. So we had made initially 1 micron particles with having a dye in them, and these are the some images and fluorescent images. And we have also measured the size of the particles in DLS, and the size was around 1 micron. We also used different molecular weights of PLG to see whether we can bring about a tunable released platform. So as you can see over in the release profile over here, lower molecular weight released the rapamycin drug within about 48 hours, while the higher molecular weight, which is 75 to 85 kD, was capable of releasing the drug for a very long duration of about 21 days. So for all our in vitro experiments, we started to use a shorter releasing period, which is the 48 hours releasing PLG molecule. And for animal experiments, we were planning to use the 21-day releasing PLG molecules. With this, what we did is we wanted to now check whether these particles can actually bring about the same effect that the free drug can actually bring. So it has already been shown in literature that rapamycin is a potential autophagy inducer. So we tested again in some chondrocytes, human chondrocyte cell lines called as C28I2. We treated the cells with the rapamycin, which is in the free form, as well as in the microparticle formulation. And we were able to also quantify and see that both as a microparticle formulation, as a free drug, the drug was quite potent in inducing autophagy in them. It is seen here quite markedly by the increased number of NC3B puncta that is present in each of the cells, whereas which is not present in the untreated type. Moving forward, we also did an interesting experiment. This has been done only, this is the first time that I have seen this experiment done in the literature, wherein when they tested these microparticles as well as the free drug on the chondrocytes that were stressed. So we all know that the chondrocytes go into stress during aging or with trauma. So when we expose these cells to this genotoxic stress or to these oxidative stress conditions, what happened is that the cells become senescent in nature. So when we added rapamycin at different concentrations, we were able to see that both as a free drug and as a microparticle, the cellular senescence numbers were coming down, which is very, very interesting because this is another way where we can actually prevent all the cells from going into senescence. We have tested the same thing to see whether there is any DNA damage that can be prevented by using these microparticles. Again, these results were capable of showing that the DNA damage is also kind of prevented by the rapamycin microparticles, which is shown over here. The next, we tested these rapamycin microparticles in a 3D culture system, which is called as these cartilage mimics or microma systems. These chondrocytes, when they are plated at a very high cell density, they form these cartilage mimics, which forms a viable 3D system in which we can test our drug formulations. Again, here, when these 3D micromasses were experiencing stress, the rapamycin microparticles were successfully able to bring them out of stress, and they were able to sustain the SGAG production by these micromasses. So with these results ahead, we went ahead and we wanted to test these in our animal models. First, we injected the longer releasing particles into the mice knee joint and we evaluated what is the residence time of those particles. It was seen over here, you can see until day 30, we were able to get the particles still present as an intra-articular form in the knee joint. While the contralateral leg, which received the free drug, they cleared the drug very fast from the knee joint. And we also wanted to see whether any localization of these particles occur. As seen over in the second picture, you can see that at day 19, the femur, tibia, menisci, and the synovium, the individual components of the joints, had some particles which are indicated here in red color, the sci-fi particles. They were also associated with all the local tissues, which is an indication that it can induce autophagy in all these tissues, as well as it can prevent senescence in all these tissues over time. We have quantified the same thing again. Next, what we did is we did... We tested the same drug system, drug particle formulation in an animal model, which had induced osteoarthritis in that. As you can see, this was a 2-month model where before even the onset of osteoarthritis occurs, we wanted to inject the drug and see whether it can prevent osteoarthritis. So here, the RMP20 mg per ml was able to bring about the same, it was not bringing any cartilage damage compared to the control shams over here, which is again quantified. So we are going ahead and using the this model as a therapeutic model. And we wanted to see that whether this rapamycin, which is having this great potential by treating osteoarthritis in the microparticle formulation, can successfully enter clinics. We are going to evaluate the therapeutic efficiency further in animal models. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you so much, Dr. Kamini. Yeah. Nice presentation.
Sure, sir.
I have a few quick questions. Yes. So what is the size of these particles?
1 micron, sir.
1 microns. So I think there are some literature where they say like less than 5 microns, these particles will kind of seep out from the knee region actually. So how do you expect these particles to stay in the knee region?
Okay, usually they are not seeping out, but they're taken up by the resident macrophages and the synovial macrophages. Both of them are in the tissue macrophages that is present in that area. These 1 micron particles have, as I've shown in the experiments, they have not been cleared so far. So I not sure whether why they're not getting cleared.
Yeah, it's a very controversial. Yeah, it's a very controversial topic where they say less than 5 micron particles, they don't really stay there in the knee region for longer actually.
Yes, so, that is true, sir. But this is something that we have found out newly, that as a rapamycin particles are specifically not getting cleared.
Yes. So is there any other questions from panelists?
So there is a question from the audience. So from Vasundhara, so does L3, L4 lumbar disc prolapsus have any effect on the knee joint?
Okay, L3, L4 is a completely different one. And knee joint osteoarthritis is a completely different one. We cannot associate both of them. And I don't think spinal problem, I'm not an authorized orthopedician to say about that. Yeah, I don't have an answer for that.
So another question which I had was, you use a fluoropore, right?
Yes, sir.
The fluorescent molecule to see your stay of particles in the knee region. So how close are these property of these fluorescent molecule with the drug which you're using?
How can you compare both of them?
Yeah, similar. I have not shown in the interest of time, but the how the drug is getting released, the same release profile has been followed by the same fluorophore. They are also hydrophobic. My drug is also hydrophobic. So they follow the same release patterns. We have evaluated that as well.
Okay. So how long do you want these particles to be in the knee region to have an effect? So do you want?
So actually, what the main importance is that every week injection has to be given for the free drug. But my particle has been, we can see that monthly twice injection I have given in the prophylactic model, and it was able to bring about some disease reduction. And now I'm trying just 1 month injection. So the patient just has to come only monthly once to the clinic and give the injection. And then I think it'll be more patient compliant with monthly once injection.
Okay, nice. Yeah. Thank you so much for your answering the questions.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you so much
for joining us. Sure.
Go to the next speaker. Sushitra Priyadarshini. She's from Department of Biotechnology, Thiruvallur University, Vellore. Sushitra? Yeah. Hi, Sushitra. So you have 8 minutes to present and then 2 minutes Q&A session. Okay. So please share your screen and start your presentation. So can you please unmute? Are you muted? Yeah. You're not audible yet. Are you muted? Can you please check whether you're muted? Yeah, you are muted actually. Yeah.
Maybe please remove your headphone, then we can try. Yeah.
Yeah.
Can you hear me, sir?
Yeah. Yeah,
I'm audible.
Yeah, you're audible.
Thank you.
Please share your slides and then you can start your presentation.
Today my topic of presentation is exploring potential peptide vaccine candidate from the envelope and surface glycoprotein of SARS-CoV-2. It is an in silico approach. So, Lord Nyosaka, MC Arish.
Yeah, please go ahead.
Yeah, sir. Okay. So coming to the introduction part, as we all know, the ongoing global pandemic has caused global pandemic coronavirus disease, COVID-19, is caused by...
We cannot see your next slide, actually. Have you changed your slides or...
Yeah, I just changed my next slide, sir.
Are you all able to see the next slide?
No.
So probably can you stop sharing and come back again?
Yeah, okay. So is this visible, sir?
Nothing changed much, actually. So can you try moving to next slide? Still, it is like totally stuck on our side, actually. So did you stop sharing? Because it is still with the first slide. The first you are...
Okay, but I'm able to see the change in slides, sir.
Okay. So can you stop sharing and come back again? Can you stop sharing once again? Just click escape. Nope.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah, now it's fine. Yeah, we could see your slides moving actually. Yeah, can you share your slide again?
Yeah, sure.
There's some network issue on your side. Suchitra, are you with us? I think she has some issue with the network. Suchitra?
Yes, sir.
Are you trying to share your screen?
Yeah, yes, sir. I'm trying to share the screen, sir.
Oh, what is the problem?
Yeah, now is it
yeah, now something visible is coming to- actually. Yeah, we are seeing your introduction slide now. Yeah, please go ahead. Yeah, we could see your introduction slide. Please go ahead.
Yeah, yes. As we all know, the present global pandemic coronavirus. Yeah, okay, sir. Present global pandemic coronavirus disease COVID-19 is caused by severe acute respiratory syndrome. To the genomic details of the SARS-CoV-2, it is positive sense RNA virus and glycoprotein or spike protein, envelope protein, membrane protein, and nucleocapsid protein. So in this study, we mainly focused on the surface glycoprotein and the envelope protein. So why we chose this is because the viral entry occurs with the interaction between the surface glycoprotein and the host cell receptor. The host cell receptor is angiotensin. Once the interaction has occurred, the envelope protein helps in the oligomerization and formation of ion channels, and thereby they are responsible for the pathogenesis. Moreover, they are also involved in the crucial steps of viral life cycle, like envelope formation, pathogenesis, budding, and assembly. So finally, this study focuses on identification of potential epitopes from the conserved regions of surface glycoprotein and envelope protein of SARS-CoV-2.
Did you change your slides by any chance?
Yes, sir. I changed my slide, sir.
But we don't see. Maybe what you could do is you can just keep the current slide and then give a slideshow probably.
Yeah, okay, sir.
Some problem, network problem with your internet. Just give a few seconds.
So is this visible, sir?
Yeah. Probably you can go like this.
Yeah, okay. But because if I change the slide, there is a problem. So I can.
Yeah.
So this is the overall research design. So from the SARS-CoV-2, we took two structural proteins, that is surface glycoprotein and envelope protein. So for the genome variation analysis and conservation analysis, we took 18 sequences from different geographical locations to analyze the to detect the mutations that had happened. So after the initial analysis, we predicted both T cell and B cell epitopes. So in the T cell epitopes, we did prediction and we did 3D modeling of the predicted epitopes. Then we moved on to the molecular docking and 2D interaction studies with their respective receptors. Likewise, the epitopes were 3D modeled and molecular docking was also carried out. So the high scoring epitopes from each protein, envelope protein and the surface glycoprotein were chosen, and a multivalent vaccine was designed. So conduct this study, we follow these methodologies. So first, multiple sequence alignment was done using ClusterW software, and the genome variation analysis and the phylogenetic analysis was done using a genome detective coronavirus typing tool. The prediction of cytotoxic T cell and analysis of binding affinity with MHC was done using NetCTL server and NetMHC PAN server 0.4. So then the helper T lymphocyte epitope prediction was done using IEDB database, and then the B cell epitopic prediction was done using ABC PRED server. Though the molecular modeling for the predicted epitopes was done using PEPFOLD3 server, and the docking was carried out by PatchDoc. The best results were refined using FireDoc, and these were viewed in UCSF camera software. Then we did the construction of a multi-epitope vaccine using the high-scoring epitopes, and the designed vaccine were characterized for their immunogenicity. So coming to my results part, these indicate the multiple sequence alignment. So with respect to the envelope protein, there were 100% similarity with the SARS-CoV-2 reference sequence. And when coming to these surface glycoprotein, we observed 99.9% similarity with the reference sequence. So the phylogenetic tree also concluded that the sequence which we retrieved all come under the same clade of SARS-CoV-2. So these are the results for genome variation analysis. With respect to the envelope protein, there were no mutation observed. And with respect to the surface glycoprotein, the mutations were observed in two levels. One is nucleotide level and protein level. The detected mutation doesn't fall under the S1 region. The S1 region is an important region in which the receptor binding region is present. So the mutation doesn't occur in the specific region. So why the epitopes doesn't fall under these regions? So these are the in the nucleotide level, there were changes in cytosine is replaced by thiamine and adenine is replaced by guanine, and there was one deletion also that is the TAT. And in protein level, aspartic acid is replaced by glycine, and deletion was also there. and arginine is replaced by valine. But these didn't affect the pathogenicity of the virus. So this is the results for the prediction of CTL epitopes and MHC1 binding affinity analysis. So totally we predicted 11 epitopes. Among them, the 5 were from the envelope protein and 6 were from the surface glycoprotein. These were based on artificial neural network predicted using NET CTL server. So this score indicate the higher score indicate the better epitopes, and the binding affinity rank, this indicate that if the rank is lesser than 0.5 percentile, then they are strong binders. So we chose top scoring epitopes for the construction of multi-epitopic vaccine. Likewise, the helper T-cell prediction was done using the IEDB database, and we predicted the top scoring epitopes based on the IC50 values.
So how long more is your presentation?
So I have 3 more slides.
Yeah.
So we also predicted the B cell epitopes. The score were higher than the threshold score. The threshold was 0.5 and we were 0.85 and 0.97 respectively. So this table concludes the molecular docking analysis results. We got a good interaction between their receptors and the ligands. So the global energy also showed the interactions are good. So these are the docking results. The green one represents the HTL epitopes. The purple one represents the B cell epitopes. The blue one represents the CTL epitopes. So these are the epitopes which we further took for the multi-epitope vaccine design. So construction of multi-epitopic vaccine. So with the highest constructed multi-epitope vaccine using the beta defensin adjuvant to enhance the immunogenicity of the vaccine. So the red colored sequence represents the adjuvant. The green colored sequence represent the linkers, and the blue one represents the epitopic regions. So to characterize the designed multi-epitope vaccine, we did antigenicity and allogenicity prediction, physicochemical characterization of the designed vaccine, and secondary and tertiary structure of the predicted vaccine. So these are the secondary and tertiary structure. So in order to identify whether the design, we did antigenicity prediction, both the
Yeah, I think it's time actually for you. So can you please conclude?
Yeah, okay. So coming to the conclusion part, the CTL, HTL and B cell epitopes from the conserved region of envelope protein and surface glycoprotein showed strong interactions with their respective receptors, which was inferred by docking and 2D structure analysis. The multi-epitopic vaccine candidate, including the high scoring CTL, HTL and B cell epitopes, for envelope and surface glycoprotein may evoke the enhanced immune response and cause multiple immunomodulatory effects due to the presence of multiple immunoantigens. And finally, I'd like to say that these designed epitope validations for clinical studies for potential COVID-19 vaccine. So thank you.
Okay, thank you so much for presenting. Since we are out of time, I'll just quickly ask one question from the audience.
Yeah, okay, sir.
Okay. So
The question is, did your analysis match the newly sequenced COVID-19 sequence from ICMR? So
yeah, yes, sir.
So it matched, huh?
Yeah, it matched. It matched.
Okay. So other question, maybe we can go for one question from panelists. Probably Dr. Raunath, if you have any questions or comments, please.
Okay. The vaccine, you told you're using some AI instruments for doing that. So what was the specific algorithm that you're using? Can you just elaborate on that?
So we didn't use any, all the servers were the online servers which were available. For CTL prediction, we used NET CTL epitopic prediction server. And for HTL epitope prediction, we used from the IEDB database. And for B-cell epitopic prediction, we used from ABC pred server.
Okay, thank you. Okay,
thank you so much for answering the questions.
I have one question.
Yeah.
So, yes, ma'am. In your study, can you predict that what type of antibody will be stimulated, like antibody A, B, which immunoglobulin?
We have to analyze further, ma'am. This is the preliminary study, so we have to analyze further to analyze like what kind of antibody will be produced by this multi-epitopic vaccine. Because we have
shown that in your study that you have characterized the allergenicity of the epitope, right? So allergenicity means you are seeing that whether it is eliciting IgE or not. So similarly, I'm asking that whether you can predict that what type of antibody will be produced.
No, we didn't analyze further, ma'am. We just made the preliminary analysis, ma'am.
Okay.
Yeah, thank you so much. Want of time, I'm going to, we'll wind up the session. Thank you so much for presenting, Suchitra.
Okay, and, thank you.
Thank you so much for everyone for attending this oral presentation session. Now I'll hand over to Dr. Raghunathan for session completion.
First of all, yeah, big thanks to all the presenters. All the talks are excellent and has a rich scientific content. Thank you all. We congratulate all the speakers for their fantastic work. We would like to thank Chairperson Dr. Arun Kumar and also our reviewers, Dr. Shati Prakash, Dr. Raunath Kumar, Dr. Sunita Nayak, and Dr. Amit Kumar for joining with us and also for helping us for evaluating the presentations. Thank you all. Nearly 500 participants attended this particular session. So I wish to thank all the participants for their active participation. We request all the participants to rejoin the next session at 2 p.m. That is again the oral presentations. That is very, very, very important session because various young research scholars, postdoctoral fellows, and as well as the faculty members are presenting their work. For attendance point of view, I want to give a clear instruction that attending a oral presentation also will be considered for attendance. So please join us in all the sessions. And also, I request the presenting authors for the next sessions, please join us 15 minutes before the session so that we can check audio, video, and screen share options. Thank you all. We shall be closing now. Please join again at 2 p.m. Thank you all.
Thank you.